We're really delighted to have with us this evening Luis Brañas, who is the executive chef for Deutsche Bank, who will introduce this evening's speaker. Thanks so much.
Good evening. Again, my name is Luis Brañas. I'm the chef at Deutsche Bank, a very, very small restaurant, which I call the Nirvana for any chef, because I can get to do whatever I want, whenever I want, for whomever I want, which is not very, and that is Monday through Friday. So no chef that you might know has the chance to do such thing. So I am very blessed in that sense. Okay, tonight, as we know, is going to be referred as math and food. One of the main components in math and food is the balance. In food, the food cannot be too spicy, because if it is so, it's not pleasant. If it is too salty, it's not pleasant. If it is anything out of balance, it's not a good experience. So we have to, first of all, think about balance. Why that goes with math? If we divide 25 into 5, and we give one of them 6, is that going to be in balance? No. 6 times 5 is 30, correct? So something is wrong. The procedure is wrong. It's not balanced. If you analyze any problem in math, it's going to be exactly like that. The result has to be balanced with the question. Food has to be balanced to be palatable. And one of the biggest problems that we have in America is the obesity. I would like you to guess what is the problem. Anybody? Yes?
Too much sugar.
Yes. So, which means what?
Balance.
Exactly. It's out of balance. But balance, if you see an artist, a painting has to be in balance. The colors have to be even. If they are not, when you look at it, it's not going to be correct. As artists, chefs are artists, because we have to deal with all these little things that are not scientifically proven, cannot be factored into an algorithm. So we have to use our senses a lot. And if something is not in balance, we're gonna have to bring that to that point. In life, it's going to be exactly the same. Balance. If we leave to work, there is no life. We have to work to live. If we eat to live, it's better than living to eat, correct? So we always have to find that very fine balance in life. The best wines, I bet most of you have read how the appreciation goes. A very well balanced with minerals and fruit and sugars, correct? Those are gonna be exceptional wines. Keyword, balance. Mercedes is taking that to a next level. It's finding the points where math, artistry, and cooking get together. There is a very nice study about the perfect rice. It's a gentleman which is a master in paellas and came to try to have the perfect recipe mathematically perfected in order to reproduce that paella anywhere. Everything was assigned to it. But as an art, whenever we are involved as humans is going to be variables that cannot be restrained into formulas. It was an awesome study. You can look up in the internet, the perfect rice is about paellas and risottos and their other names, but it's extremely interesting the way it was approached. Now, the only thing that I don't find balance right now is between my experience and my achievements compared with those of Mrs. Siles. She has achieved so much. If I could read her resume, or a brief resume, I would have to use the rest of the evening. She has published everywhere. She's been a lecturer in Europe, of course, Asia, Africa, here in United States, in Latin America, Oceania. She's been everywhere. She's recognized worldwide. She's a professor in algebra, something that I forgot about right after I finished that lesson in college, in school. I couldn't understand after that. So that is the only thing, and I am proud to introduce Mercedes to you. She is one of the persons that I know that has achieved this level of knowledge and is capable of bringing us this unique concept of food, math, artistry, and her new endeavors, which will be, I do not know if I shall say or not, you might be seeing in this very museum. Mercedes Siles, please, a round of applause for her. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I cannot recognize myself in his words. Okay, thank you very much for coming. Good evening. I would like to start by thanking Cindy Lawrence, Glenn Whitney, and the MOMAD for their invitation to deliver this talk, for being here today in the Cycle Math Encounters. It's a great honor for me to be here. Also to the executive chef, Luis Brañez, for his wonderful presentation of me, or about something who is Mercedes Siles, but not exactly me. So maybe after these few words I have pronounced, maybe you will have recognized that I have a Spanish accent. So when people think about Spain, these are the images that immediately comes to mind. Toros, toreros, toreador, as they are called in the opera Carmen by Bizet, flamenco, of course, bailaora, and fiesta. It's very common to think that we Spanish people like parties very much. Well, this is true, but I think that also you American people like parties very much. It is thought that we Spanish people organize them frequently, that we are experts on that. These are the images to represent Spain. Perhaps they are true, but there are more things. How many famous Spaniards do you know?
Enrique Iglesias.
Say it again.
Enrique Iglesias.
Oh, good for you. Yes, he's Spanish, you are right. There are famous Spanish who did very interesting things, as the architect Rafael Gustavino, you can see him here, who emigrated to New York at the end of the 19th century, where he patented the Gustavino tile. This is a tile art system for constructing self-supporting arches and architectural vaults using interlocking terracotta tiles and layers of mortars. Gustavino tiles can be found in some of the New York's most important buildings, for example, in the hall of the Central Station, you can see here, or in the Oyster Bar, in the underground of the station. And this year, the New York City Museum had an exhibition on Gustavino, and his song from 26 March until the 7th of September. Another Spanish closely related to New York is this person, is the engineer and mathematician Leonardo Torres Quevedo. Among other things, he invented the Spanish aerocar, which is in the Niagara Falls, were inaugurated in 1916 and now is still working. The States, and particularly New York, have always drawn the attention of the Spaniards, me included. Guastavino and Torres Quevedo are examples for this, as it is, for example, Federico García Lorca. He's a very well-known writer. One of his masterpieces is Poet in New York, which was written in New York here among 1920 and 1921, while he was staying as a visitor at Columbia University. Lorca is recognized for being the most read Spanish poet in the world. There are also Spanish who are universal, for example, Pablo Picasso, born in Malaga, the city where I'm living. He painted doves without feet, and it is said that his father asked him to paint the feet for the doves for his own pictures, and that Pablo hated this. This is the reason because he didn't paint it, the feet of his doves. One of such is this one, is in the emblem for the University of Malaga, the university where I'm professor. And there are also Spanish who are very famous in different settings, as the one said there, that of architecture, painting, engineering, literature, as we have seen. And another example in literature is Miguel de Cervantes. He's the father of Don Quixote, as you can recognize. He represents Don Quixote, those who does things because they believe that they have to do their correct thing. And there are all known Spanish people and young Spanish, as for example, Rafael Nadal. He's considered one of the best tennis players in the world. I don't know if he's now the first, the second, or the third, but in any case, he's one of the best. And there are very famous and beautiful Spanish persons. For example, Penelope Cruz, and famous and handsome. For example, Antonio Banderas. This means that you know him. Also born in Malaga as Pablo Picasso. However, not all the Spaniards are so beautiful or so famous or devote our lives to architecture, painting, literature, sport, or cinema. And here you will see an example, me. Let me speak very briefly about me. Let me explain you my culinary dreams through mathematics. I'm a mathematician, I'm an algebraist, and you can see here the real world. This is the blackboard in my office, and you can see the research we are doing about Lebesgue path algebras. This is real life. I mean, this is real algebra. So these are the mathematical schemes in the title of this talk. So I do teaching, advise PhD students, I do research, organize conferences, research school in developing countries, I deliver talks, scientific talks, and also divulgation talks, I devise and curate exhibitions, etc. And apart from my scientific interest, there is another one that I enjoyed very much, and this is to approach science to society, in particular, to approach algebra and mathematics to society. There are infinitely many ways of doing this, of doing an approximation from mathematics to society. For example, the one that first came to the mind of a mathematician, I mean, is by using numbers, using equations. This takes part in the development of the internet, appears in coding theory, in cryptography, etc. These are different ways of showing how mathematics, how algebra applies to real life. And 3 years ago, I started to think how to approach mathematics to society, but in a non-customary way. I mean, I wanted to get an approach able to arouse different feelings, and I started the search for that approach. Sometimes, when we start to search inspiration for an idea, we used to do this from outside to inside. And as far as our source of inspiration is, we think that more original is going to be the result. However, it is possible that the real inspiration lies inside yourself. So the only thing we have to do is to look inside us, to put some water on it, and a lot of new ideas. And that was my experience. So two of my hobbies, I have to say, well, apart from mathematics, are cookery and photography. So that the inner search drove me to the idea that what I had to do was to integrate mathematics, cookery, and photography in order to get that approach to people from mathematics. From mathematics. Okay. So that I started to see very elaborated images. You can see here food, cheese, olives, tomatoes, and the geometrical figures appeared. Some of them first, more after a while, and all of them inspired, for example, by pictures, as this one that you can see by Salvador Dalí, whose title is Galatea of the Spheres. And I thought in taking photographs of those images, in finding the infinite in them, the vanishing point, the perspective, the symmetry, the parallelism, etc. I'm not a professional chef, but I know a very good chef in Spain, José Carlos García from Malaga, prized with a Michelin star, whose cooking I appreciate very much. I'm not a professional photographer, but I have a friend, Pedro Reyes Dueñas, who is also a mathematician and a photographer. And this means that his looking at life is like my looking, is mathematical, but also artistic. So that with my ideas in mind, I contacted both of them, the chef and the photographer, and that was the starting point of a work that lasted 1 year and a half. And this was also the starting point of my personal exploration of the relationship among mathematics and cookery. There was also a motivation. This motivation was the Royal Spanish Mathematical Society. 2011 was the centenary of the society. I belong it, and I belong to its governing board. So I wanted to do something special for that special occasion. And the result was the two exhibitions I will speak about, which are The Taste of Mathematics and Parallel Universes Dialoguing. I will speak about them later, but before I will try to explain you which is the connection between mathematics and cookery, always from my point of view. So the connection between mathematics and cookery, from my point of view, can be divided into three steps. First, mathematics in the kitchen, in the everyday life. Then mathematics as a source of inspiration. And then mathematics and cookery as arts. Let's start with the first one, math in the kitchen. Shapes. The materials used in the kitchen, for example, here, or here, or here, have mathematical shapes. The dishes we use have mathematical shapes, the bowls where we put food, or even the decoration for a marvelous table. For example, the fruits we buy in the market, see here. For example, the fish we eat, or this is the fish. Or for example, here, the sweets we like, but also in the everyday life, the bottles, the glasses we use in the everyday life. You can see here always shapes. All of these are shapes, this is geometry, but there are also algebra, there are more things. For example, assume that you're going to prepare a gazpacho. A gazpacho is a Spanish cold soup. I think that everybody knows what is a gazpacho, but you will see that this is a special gazpacho because it's the recipe of José Carlos García of a strawberry gazpacho with Iberico ham and oyster snow. So to prepare it, we need, I will give you the recipe later if you want, you will need 500 grams of tomatoes, 500 grams of strawberries, and more things. And in the end, 50 grams of Iberico ham. And you go to your fridge and you find, oh my God, we have only 350 grams of strawberries. What to do then? This is something terrible because you want to impress someone or because you want to enjoy yourself, your meal with this special recipe. So obviously what you do is to prepare the gazpacho with the amount you have so that you have to change these amounts. So instead of 500 grams of tomatoes, you will use what? 350 grams of tomatoes, exactly. Instead of the 500 grams of strawberries, you will use the amount you have. This means 350 grams of strawberries. And what about the ham? You will use what? Exactly, 35 grams of Iberico ham. Great. This means that what you did is the following. Instead of 500, you put 350 grams of red tomatoes. Instead of 500 strawberries, you put 350. And instead of 50 grams of ham, you put 35 grams. And what you did is to keep the balance, as Luis says. What you did is that this amount, this is constant. This division is the same as this one and is the same as this one. And this is called the two-thirds rule. So this is mathematics. So that you find in the kitchen geometry, shapes. You also find algebra, but you also find, for example, fractions. If you want to divide a cake or something into a particular number of pieces, then you have to use fractions. And you find measure of mass, of capacity, of time, etc. But there is more. Maybe we need to know the amounts of different food we need. We can do a statistical analysis of the amounts of the different ingredients we use in the kitchen. For example, if you own a restaurant, or if we want to save some money, in the restaurant, for example, they have very good programs, and Luis knows about this, to optimize the expenses depending on the gains, on the cost of food. And for example, this one, this is called a sampling. So that we can find in the kitchen geometry, algebra, statistics, optimization, and much more. What about mathematics and as a source of inspiration? Well, I try to show you that math can be a source of inspiration, for example, for cooking. Parallelism, perpendicularity, symmetries, geometrical forms, algebraic surfaces, and more are a source of inspiration in high cooking, and I try to show this. They are also a source of inspiration for the taste of mathematics. What is the taste of mathematics? For example, can you imagine to associate a taste? I'm finishing about asking which is the taste of mathematics. Which is the taste, for example, of your favorite building? Think about the Empire State Building. Could you imagine a flavor for that? Or something related to cooking for that? For example, you have here something. Here you have a suggestion. So the imagination you need to associate a taste to a building is just the imagination you need to look at an algebraic surface, to turn it around, and imagine it on a dish. So I had culinary dreams. I imagined cubes, spheres, cones, spirals, complicated algebraic surfaces in the culinary creations of José Carlos García. Here you can see him. I imagine juices in the dishes, decorating them in perfect or imaginary parallel lines that disappeared in the infinite. And with this mad idea in mind, this mad idea of mathematician, I have avoided to say mad mathematician. So with this idea in mind, I went to explain him which was the idea. I went with my computer and the program called Surfer. You can find it here in the MoMath upstairs, and you can play with it and can also download it from the internet. So I never asked Jose Carlos what did he think about me when I explained that I wanted to put mathematics in her dishes, in his dishes. And I think that it's better not to ask him now. So the fact is that he and his team liked the idea and they started to work on it. Previously, I have an encounter with Pedro Reyes Dueñas, the photographer and also mathematician, to plan everything. And here you can see our team. I have to recognize that our meetings, the meeting between a mathematician and a chef, a mathematician and a photographer, and the meeting among all of three, were really exciting, plenty of energy, very intense. And I think that we were able to show that multidisciplinary teams can give birth to surprising results. And in what follows, I'm going to show you the results. I'm going to show you the taste of mathematics. For example, here you have the orange blossom meringue that you will recognize from the poster of the conference. Or here you have the almond nougatine with sand of pistachio that you will build in a while using the scissors and your hands are on the table. You will see different colors to build this. And here you can see parallel lines of caramel. You can see here cubes made of the sand of pistachio. Here you have the dry floury sweet of hazelnut with chocolate and gold. Eating gold, of course. And you can see cubes, parallelepipeds, etc. It follows the donut of wine, made of the white of the egg with sugar, not too much sugar to get the balance, and also with wine. These are typical from Malaga. Now, the bitter chocolate with raspberries. You can see the lines of honey, the semi-spheres here of raspberries. You can see that the beautiful reflections are really incredible in this picture. It follows the macaron of dried fruits, aligned and ready to be tasted. Now, the strawberries with tiles of coral and cocoa. Look at the red line of the infinite just here, inviting you. You can see also the chocolate. You can see the cylinder that seems to follow this path made of cocoa. Here, something salty, the stick tartare with cylinder of cigarette. The reflection you can see is part of the geometrical form. You will see later. Now, the tomato pearls and liquid basil, and observe the beauty of asymmetry. The glass is situated on the right-hand side in the photograph, transmits a feeling of movement, but this movement is very peaceful. Now, the cracking nest with lemon ice cream. And I have to say that the foam was really delicious, well, as the rest, of course. Now, the helicoid of olive oil, an uncomplicated form and a strong photograph. Now, the tiles of flowers, which are a beautiful culinary landscape, where to get lost. Don't you think so? You have just seen the tasties. Through the eyes of a photographer, through the eyes of the cooker, and through the eyes of a mathematician. And in what follows, you will see the math. Here are the math. For example, you can see here the tenth. You can see here the algebraic formula is just here. Algebraic means that the only things you use are x, y, and z, which are the three coordinates in the space. You can multiply, sum, put numbers, real numbers here, and this is all. And this is called, the result is called an algebraic surface. So the set of all the dots in this figure satisfied this equation. So you can see here the equation, algebra, the shape, geometry, and the cooking. Very tasteful. Here you can see, for example, the Kreisel and the formula. Now, the Kreutz and the formula. The Kreutz is just the intersection of the three planes in the space. Here, the pipe. What is this? It's a cylinder. Here you can see the dulo, which is as a donut. You can see the formula also. And here, the cube, exactly. This is the cube. And this is the one, is the, do you know what is this one, the meaning of this one? Is the length of this side. Here you can see, well, this is difficult to know. This is called ellipsoid in mathematics. Here you have the bootshaving with a very complicated formula. I don't know if you can read this, but it's really complicated. And also the helicoid and the cylinder, a spring as we used to call it. You can see here, I have said that all the formulas are algebraic, but this is not completely true, because you can see that this formula is algebraic. This is the formula for this cylinder. And can you tell me what is this one? The radius of the cylinder. Exactly. And you can see here that it appears a cosine. So this means that this formula is not algebraic. So all the formulas are algebraic except this one. And this formula appears here because the chef wanted to have this nice shape. And they wanted to do this with olive oil. So this is the reason, because we have all the formulas algebraic except this one. And here you can see what? Which are these shapes? This is a sphere, and this is a cone, exactly, good. And here you can see the citrus with the formula. The citrus is called like this because it's similar to a citron. And the first time that the collection of the Taste of Mathematics was exhibited was here. This is Malaga, this is a building, the building of the university, a historical and very beautiful building. And you can see here the collection in the exhibition room. The Taste of Mathematics consists of 36 photographs in color. I have shown you some of them, as well as 12 solarizations. The solarization is a process in photography by means of which the image appearing is totally or partially reversed. Reverse mean in tone, that is, dark areas appear light or light appear dark. Well, this is not exactly a solarization, it's a kind of solarization, it's a process more complicated, and the photographer used digital technology for doing that. So apart of the 36 photographs with the culinary landscapes and the solarizations, the Taste of Mathematics shows also the work in the restaurant. There are 40 pictures in black and white explaining how is life in the restaurant. Here you can see some of them. For example, the preparation of the tables in the restaurant, the preparation of the room, the preparation of the meals, of the foams, also the research, which is done in the restaurant, and also something important, the cleaning, the experiments, the presentation of the meal, and finally, the most important thing, the team. The photographs explain in an ordered way the history of what happens in that working place, where the chefs shape the tastes of imagination. In this case, they also shape the taste of mathematics. And I like to explain, when you see this photograph, I like to explain that this is as a theorem. You know that in a theorem, you have two parts. The first one, which is the statement, and the second one, which is the explanation, the proof. So this is what you get, the statement of the theorem, and this is the proof of the theorem in black and white, because it's the part, it's the hardest part. So the photographs were also exhibited here. I think this is the most beautiful at the moment where the exhibition has been. This is Santiago de Compostela. It was exhibited in a church. You can see here the contrast in between the church and the images of food. And coming soon to the MoMA here. These are the places where the exhibition has been. Twice in Malaga, then in Panama, in Santiago de Compostela, in Alaurín el Grande, a city close to Malaga. It will be here, also in Granada, in Bogotá, and in more places where we are speaking to translate the exhibition there. And let me tell you as an anecdote that the only collection in printed photographs that exist was this one. It was a present for the Prince of Spain, now King of Spain, Felipe VI, on occasion of a meeting with the Royal Spanish Mathematical Society 2 years ago. And this is me. Okay. I have divided the talk into three parts. I have explained you two of the three. And I think we are going to stop just now for the workshop. So I'm going to explain what do you have to do. There are two different activities. The first one, you have this. You have also pins, aluminum. And this is what you have to do with the aluminum, to put around the cylinder or around the sphere you have. Then you have the marshmallows, and you have to use your imagination to build something special, a culinary landscape. For example, this one, which is very mathematical, or this one that maybe you can recognize immediately because it's the Empire State Building, or maybe this one. So this is one. So these are for inspiration. We did this, I did this with my students in Malaga just to have an idea of what we wanted to do. And then you have another activity, you have this, you have to cut, and you have to build this thing. This is the chef who did the plate you have seen. This is what you have to get. The intersection of the three planes. So please start, and if I can help you, so you have 20 minutes to work. And then I will give you a mark. Do you want to start with that, with the bowls, with the... You have, for example, a landscape. Okay, you have to use the pins and the marshmallows. Another one. Yes, yes, good idea. You can do this, but you will see here. Yes, really. Yes. One of these is the last one.
Oh.
So this is the secret.
This is the first one.
Yes, and you have to put this inside, from the inside.
I'm just wondering, like, you said a bank?
Yes.
Like, what's the interest of the bank in terms of promoting?
There's no compare. I mean, Spanish culinary.
Thank you.
And now, yes, yes, exactly. Oh, you are clever.
Oh,
this is incredible. Good imagination. Oh, you built. This is incredible. What about the three planes? Okay. This is an strange culinary landscape.
It's like a meteor or something.
So we are going to continue. But before I start with the third part, I would like you to come here, everybody with his piece, with his culinary landscape, his or her. Please come here. We will take a picture of you. Wow. These are incredible. More people came here, please. Look at the camera and show the camera your work, please. So a picture for the workers, for the hard workers. Thank you very much. Another one, please. Another picture. thank you very much. Okay, thank you. Here you have, thank you very much. So we will continue. Okay. Thank you very much for working. I'm going to finish. I'm going to continue with the third part. We can eat the marshmallows, but not now, because we don't want you to be ill. So please, look at me. So summarizing, we were speaking about the relationship I have found between mathematics and cookery. And summarizing, we have spoken about math in the kitchen, in the everyday life, about math as a source of inspiration, and we have explored the taste of mathematics. And finally, I will speak about math and cookery as arts. Thank you. What do you think that people here in the picture is doing? This is an exhibition room, and people is looking at photographs of mathematicians at work and of chefs at work, both in their respective creative processes. I feel curious about the opinion of people concerning mathematics. For example, I would like to know which is your opinion about mathematics. You can explain it later when we finished. But I assume that you like mathematics because otherwise you will not be here. So for that reason, because of my curiosity, every time I can, I ask people about that. And last time was this October, at the beginning of October, to my students in the first year of mathematics. So I wanted to know why they did decide to study mathematics, which do they think is the utility of mathematics, and I also asked them about their perspectives, and also about the work that, from their point of view, a mathematician develops. And I have to say that their answers were incredible. The reason to study mathematics were curiosity, challenge, love for reasoning, love for perfection, and beauty. There are more. They think that mathematics are beautiful. Of course, I also think that mathematics are beautiful, that there is an intrinsic beauty in mathematics. And this is not only my opinion. Through years, mathematicians have been interested in showing the existence of such a beauty. And the way of doing this is by comparison with other arts. For example, with painting, with music, with architecture. Hardy, the Cambridge mathematician, said, "I'm interested in mathematics only as a creative art. Math are creative." I recommend to read an article from The New Yorker by Alexander Nazarian, where he says that writers should learn mathematics. One of the reasons for this affirmation is that the writers who have deep knowledge of mathematics produces more creative and more incredible books. And he mentioned several examples. For example, you will know Lewis Carroll, Thomas Pynchon, and also David Foster Wallace. And I, someone know him very deeply. Okay. And I would like to add one person. I would like to add José Echegaray, Nobel Prize of Literature in 1904, and he's considered the best Spanish mathematician in the 19th century. It is argued that mathematics are an art because they produce beauty, and this beauty is shown to be by comparison, to exist by comparison of the results in mathematics and the result in that art. However, we have not found, at least as far as we know, a comparison among the creative processes in mathematics and in an art. And this is what we propose, considering cookery as an art. So we affirm that it is possible to find a deep dialogue between mathematics and cookery. Here you can see a chef and a mathematician dialoguing. And here you can see a dialogue without sound, a dialogue of words, of ideas. And you know that both dialogues are also possible. It is possible to taste the dream of mathematics. Here you can see the mathematician and the chef discussing what they can offer. The chef, his culinary schemes, and the mathematician, her mathematical dreams. Both chefs and mathematicians need loneliness to create in their offices, for example, in their kitchen. Both search for the idea for a theorem, for an unexpected result, the idea for a delicious recipe. And suddenly, you know that the idea can arise in the office, in the kitchen, even while dreaming. And this idea takes form, as you can see here. We also feel passion for what we do, create theorems, create plates, and explain both. And we need to have them written to let other people to know what we did. Once we have finished our last creation, we are afraid because we don't know if we will be able to create again something similar or even something better, which is what we prefer. But we are happy if we get recognition, public recognition, or in the web or all over the world. I especially like this second picture, this second photograph, because it's a wish more than a reality. Here you can see a mathematician thinking that she would like to be famous, but this is only an idea because it's reflected in the computer, but it's not inside the computer or inside the news. So this is because I found a lot of poetry inside this picture. Sorry for saying this. Okay. So sometimes the success arrives as a public recognition because what we did was marvelous. And also, this is about the pictures I spoke about. And other times we suffer because we are afraid of the oblivion of the others. For example, here. And these are the different steps followed in the creative process. These are loneliness, searching for the idea when the idea takes form, the passion for what we do, and this was the exhibition Parallel Universes Dialoguing. But in the end, we are happy because are we and our passions, passion for mathematics, passion for cookery, and passion for both. Many thanks for your attention.
Happily, we have a little bit of time this evening. If anybody has any questions about cooking, math, or the combination of the two for tonight's speaker, please just raise your hand, wait for the microphone to come to you, and we can hear more to say. Okay, I see a question right here.
Oh, thank you. That was really inspirational. I was just wondering, what do you think of people taking photographs of food? Because, I mean, that's very popular, but this is something different.
Yes.
So I was just curious to see what you think.
About this?
About just people, you know,
taking pictures of
food and then uploading it, you know, to share with their friends. Do you think part of it is also recognizing the math or not?
I'm not sure if I understand the question, because you say what I think about people sharing their pictures, I found great. But this happens all over the world, because I think that a lot of people, instead of enjoying the moment, they take pictures, explain their friends what they are doing. But you have to take, well, my opinion is that you have, if you are here, you have to enjoy here. Then you will explain. Maybe you can take a picture or two, but you have to be here and to enjoy. And to enjoy with other people and speak and share ideas. So does this answer your question?
What is your next exhibition going to be about?
It's coming.
Hi.
Well, our plans now are working with Berrocal. I don't know if you know Miguel Berrocal. He's a sculptor. Was very famous because of Martin Gardner. This is the centenary of Martin Gardner, and he wrote in Scientific American. He wrote an article about Miguel Berrocal, because their constructions were like puzzles, were very mathematical. So now I'm working with Berrocal's foundation and also with the MOMAD, and there will be an exhibition here about Berrocal. And the following step, who knows?
How do you get olive oil, a liquid, to fix itself into a spiral formation?
You have to ask the chef. I think they put in some place and they use in, it's cold. It's iced, I think, and they use this. I cannot explain exactly how to do, but I can give you the mail of Jose Carlos Garcia, and you can ask him. Maybe this is a secret.
I think that you can make an emulsion with olive oil, like, and it kind of turns it into like a mayonnaise, or you whip it almost so the fat's like, something happens with the fat and it becomes a lot more like a cream kind of, and then you can freeze it or put it in a.
You are a very good cooker.
You were mostly using parallel lines and more solid geometry, but did you think about using anything like fractals?
Yes. This is a very good idea. And in fact, you can do this with chocolate. For example, I don't know if you remember one of the pieces, the donut was inside, I'm going to show you. There is chocolate here. This has been made. You can do fractals like this one. This is an easy fractal. You repeat the square a number of times. If you do this with different colors and with different shapes and you continue, then you can do something similar. This is a fractal. So yes, you can use fractals.
Okay, I think that wraps up for tonight. Let's give our speaker one more big hand.
Thank you.